to sing. New arrangements of old songs, we like to find some new songs to sing. And we like to find different ways, different things to focus on the Christmas story. Maybe we focus on the characters, maybe we focus on the reason Jesus came. Today we're focusing on Bethlehem. And so we want to look at Bethlehem, past and present. The history and the significance of Bethlehem began long before Jesus was born in a manger. And we will talk about, you know, discover some ways, some times, and some people that took place around in Bethlehem long before Jesus was born. So I just pray that something that is said or sung today would bless your heart. And there's lots of familiar carols in this, so when a familiar song comes, sing with us. Okay, so now we present to you Bethlehem.
As there was on the first Christmas Eve. Instead, there is fighting and rioting with no end in sight. Diplomats are making plans to arrive after the holidays for peace talks, but on everyone's mind tonight is whether or not this little town can hold on for that long. Excuse me, sir. Can you give me your input on the situation?
It's bad here. It's always been bad. There's no hope.
And what is your name, ma'am?
Hi, I'm Teresa.
Teresa, on this holiday, we talk about peace on Earth. Do you think that peace is possible?
My parents used to talk about peace being possible and that it comes from God. But, you know, I think God has forgotten all about us.
Well, there doesn't seem to be much hope for the people in Lincoln. As the world watches and waits, we do hope and pray for the best. In Bethlehem, I'm Bertha.
Wait just for a minute, young lady.
And what is your name, sir?
My name is Simeon.
All right, Simeon, what are your thoughts on the situation? Do you think that peace is possible?
Strange you should ask me that on this night.
Look, sir, I don't want to disrespect you, but I have to wrap this broadcast up, so...
This world doesn't need more people telling them that peace is impossible or that God has forgotten about them. What they need is more people telling them that peace is exactly what God has in mind.
I know that that is all what we're thinking, especially on this night.
Not just this night, but every night. If you are willing, I'll take you on a journey and introduce you to others who have experienced God's peace and have seen His promises kept firsthand.
I don't know.
It'll be worth your time, I promise you.
Will it bring me high ratings? I need to beat the other metrics.
Going where God calls you will bring you much better rewards and higher ratings. Are you ready?
What do I have to lose?
Coming through.
not in your time.
I don't remember being in a fancy sports car or a phone booth.
That's because we're not in one of your American movies. There's someone I would like you to meet who will start us off on our journey.
Hello, Jimmy.
Ruth, it's good to see you.
You mean Ruth from the Bible?
I'm not sure what you mean.
Remember, the Bible hasn't been written yet.
Right. So you're the one that traveled here with your mother-in-law.
Yes, I am. Naomi and I traveled back here after our husbands died at home. We weren't sure what we were going to do, only that we couldn't stay there. We were so poor we had to go into the fields and pick up the leftover meat that the workers dropped, just so that we could stay alive.
Did you ever wonder if God had forgotten about you?
About a widow from a foreign country sometimes, but I had made a promise to Naomi that her God would be my God and that I trusted him no matter what.
And was it worth it? Did things turn around for you?
I thought you knew my story.
It's been a while since I went to church. What happened?
Well, God said Boaz was a distant relative of Naomi's. We married and he has taken care of both of us since our dad, so Jesse and his wife have just had their eighth son, a tiny little boy named David. We just know that he's going to use one of those boys, just not sure which one.
It sounds like things have worked out for you. I'm not sure what that has to do with what is happening now, in my time.
Just wait. I have many more people I want you to meet.
David was the youngest son of Jesse, who was the grandson of Ruth and Boaz. David was a shepherd for his father's sheep. He had time while he was out in the fields taking care of the sheep to write 73 psalms. Psalms are songs and praises to God. Mary, Rita, and Trinity are three of David's lambs. They will recite Psalm 23, 1 through 3a after me. The Lord is my shepherd.
The Lord is my shepherd.
I shall not want.
I shall not want.
He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. Okay, listen to me. He restoreth my soul.
Giant with my slingshot?
So what just happened?
the prophet Samuel came to our house today. He said that one of Jesse's sons was going to be the next king of Israel. A king of Israel coming from Bethlehem. Can you imagine? So anyway, we started with my oldest brother and kept on going down the line, stopping at each one. I guess God told Samuel that none of them worked, so he asked my father if he had another son. He said yes, out in the fields watching the sheep. So he sent a servant to come and get me. As soon as I walked in, God told Samuel that I was the one. He anointed my head with oil and said something about how man looks at the outward appearance, but God looks at the heart.
I think I've read that somewhere before.
So anyways, I really felt like God was there in the room with me, like he had his arms around me, you know? But then my father said I had to get back to the sheep before they were eaten by bears. So that's where I'm going now. See ya.
But David didn't become king for many more years. I'm surprised he didn't give up.
I'm sure he wanted to. But in the scriptures, David is known as a man after God's own heart. He always remembered the Lord. Even when he failed, he always came back to him.
So Ruth taught us that God takes care of us, and David taught us that God always keeps his promises, even if it's not when they think they should be fulfilled. These are good things to learn, but I'm still not sure what that has to do with the world in 2013.
Just keep listening.
probably won't know it.
I see.
So your government is really making you travel this far when you're about to give birth? And I thought paying taxes was bad.
That's why we're traveling. Caesar wants to take a census so that he can tax it properly. Everyone has been instructed to go to the town of their birth. Since Joseph is from Bethlehem, this is where we need to go.
So, this baby is going to be your first then?
That's right, and it came about in a very unusual way.
I heard a little bit about that.
I'm not surprised. Nazareth is a small town, and as crazy as it seems, this child really was conceived by the Holy Spirit.
I believe you.
It has been hard. There has been gossip about me being unfaithful, but God also told Joseph that I was telling the truth. He has stood by me and trusted as well.
So God sends people into our lives when it's hard for us to trust him.
He definitely does. King Solomon wrote that one can put 1,000 to flight, but two can put 10,000 to flight. He wants us to build each other up and encourage each other. Together, Joseph and I are going to see God's promise and come to pass.
Prophecies fulfilled, watching wonder as God sits on our side.
the mother of Jesus.
Yes, an amazing young lady, isn't she? I remember when I first met her.
Tell me about it.
Soon. First, I have a few more people I would like you to meet.
Good day, Your Majesty.
No need to do that, I am not that important.
From what I remember of the Christmas story, you must be the three kings, or wise men. What exactly do you do anyway?
My friends and I study the stars. We're from a distant country and have been making our way home. This is a different route than we had planned to go.
Right. The angel told you to go this way.
How did you know?
Martha.
I know, I was just excited to know this part of the story.
Well, the whole thing was pretty incredible. About 2 years ago, we saw the gigantic star and knew that a new king was going to be born in Bethlehem. After reading the ancient prophecies, we didn't believe it was happening now in our lifetime.
So you left? Just like that?
Just like that, we packed up our belongings and some gifts.
I know this one.
Gold, frankincense, and myrrh to honor the child. We got as far as Jerusalem and asked for an audience with King Herod.
Big mistake there.
Very true, but we thought that we should speak to someone in charge who knew where the baby was supposed to be.
Couldn't you have just kept following the star?
I guess we thought the king would be interested in the ancient prophecies. He pretended to be anyway. He gave us more provisions and told us when we found the baby to come back and tell him so he could worship him too.
And you believed him?
We had no reason not to. We followed the star right to where Jesus' house was. While we were sleeping, an angel came to all of us and told us that we needed to go home in a different direction because Herod was going to try harming the child.
So you left just because of a dream you had? Did you tell Mary and Joseph? Is the child okay?
Jesus is fine. God also told Joseph to take his family and flee into Egypt. They are on their way there right now.
Wow. Imagine if you hadn't listened to that angel. I mean, it doesn't really make sense.
I guess when you say it that way, it doesn't. But one thing we are learning is that sometimes God asks us to do something important that doesn't make sense. But when you trust and obey Him, things will go better for us and people around us.
I suppose you're right.
Well, we better get going. We have a long trip ahead of us.
It was nice meeting you.
I sure hope you've learned something from this tonight.
I learned a lot, but I'm still not sure what all that has to do with 2013. I mean, all those stories were nice for them, but that was a long time ago. What does that have to do with me, with the rest of the world?
Do we have peace on Earth yet?
Not at all. Look around you. People fighting all over the place.
But what's one of the names that scriptures give Jesus?
One of the counselor, mighty God, everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. I guess I was paying attention in Sunday school after all.
So if we don't have peace on Earth yet, and God has promised it to us,
then it is something we can still wait for.
That's correct. I think it's time you've heard my story.
I would love to.
Now there was a man in Jerusalem called Simeon, who was righteous and devout. He was waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit was on him. It had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not die before he had seen the Lord's Messiah. Moved by the Holy Spirit, he went into the temple courts. When the parents brought in the child, Jesus, to do for him what the customs of the law required, Simeon took him in his arms and praised God, saying, Sovereign Lord, as you have promised, you may now dismiss your servant in peace, for my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the sight of all nations, a light for revelation to the Gentiles, and the glory of your people Israel. The child's father and mother marveled at what was said about him. Then Simeon blessed them and said to Mary, his mother, This child is destined to cause the falling and rising of many in Israel, and to be a sign that will be spoken against, so that the thoughts of many hearts will be revealed, and the sword will pierce your own soul too.
That is amazing. So God allowed you to be one of the first people to really know who Jesus was.
Yes, and it was a great privilege.
And we can be confident that everything God has promised us is going to come to pass, even though it's hard for us to see. He has not forgotten about us, just like he hadn't forgotten about you, Mary, David, or Ruth.
He created this world, and he won't forget about any one of us. When Jesus first came into this world, there was violence and unrest. The people were frustrated and confused. And God gave us such an amazing gift.
And that gift belongs to us today. So that even when things don't feel peaceful around us, we can have the peace of God in our hearts.
And all you have to do is ask.
Yeah. Thank you so much to each one who helped put this on. I want to say thank you to Leanne Weber for writing the script for our drama. Also, I want to say thank you to Jake for painting that backdrop. Esther for having the dream for this and the vision and helping bring it to pass. Everyone who brought cookies, everybody's invited to have some cookies afterwards. And thank you to the choir that have been practicing for 67 weeks. Yeah. I want you to think for a moment about God keeping his promises. You know, this all begins way back in Genesis chapter 3. Genesis chapter 3, God is talking to Adam and Eve and the serpent, and he says to the serpent, he says, "You're going to strike the heel of Eve's descendants, but he will crush your hand." You remember that scene in the movie where Jesus is there in the Garden of Gethsemane, and the snake is slithering around, and he goes like this, saying, was crushing the head of the serpent. Crushing the head, defeating death, defeating sin. And it's important for us to think about that this morning because God keeps his promises, doesn't he? See, even back in Genesis, the children of Israel go to Egypt. And they're in Egypt because Satan knows that God keeps his promises. He works behind the scenes, and there's the king of the Pharaoh who's trying to kill all the male babies. Why? So God can't keep his promise. You move on now, and there's 400 years of silence in between the end of the Old Testament and the coming of Jesus. And maybe people were wondering, does God keep his promises? See, and then Satan tries again, doesn't he? When Herod has all the male babies in the city of Bethlehem killed. But God keeps his promises. And here's Simeon, who's waiting for the fulfillment of the prophetic scriptures to come to pass. I read one to you this morning as we begin the service out of Micah. But you, Bethlehem, out of you will come a ruler. A virgin shall conceive and bring forth a son, and he'll call his name Emmanuel. Why is that important? Because God keeps his promises. He's faithful, isn't he? John describes it like this in the gospel. He says, he came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. But to as many as received him, he gave the right to become children of God. See, he didn't come the way that they thought he was going to come. They thought he was going to come as a king and throw off the rule of Rome. And he came as a baby. And he came to a poor family. And 8 days later, when they go to the temple to dedicate him and go through the ritual ceremony, Simeon is there. Simeon offers praise to God. Why? Because God keeps his promises. See? He's faithful. And the thing that he says to us this morning is, if you will open the door of your heart, I will come in and have fellowship with you and you with me. See? But to all who received him, he gave the right to become children of God. I just want to ask you this question before we sing our final song this morning. Have you received him? Christmas has a lot of trappings with it. There's presents and there's gifts and there's lights and there's trees and there's music. But if you come to Christmas and you have not received him into your life, you've missed it. Because that's what it's all about. Jesus came into our world, he as a human, he left glory and came down to earth. he wanted to be in your life. He wanted to give you the opportunity to have forgiveness of sin and the joy of having Jesus in your life. And I just want to ask you this question. When did you receive him? When did you open the door of your heart and allow him to come in? He knocks at the door of every heart. There are times in our lives where he shows up and he knocks at the door of our heart. But because you've got a free will, you've got to open it and receive him in. If you don't do that, you've missed it, what Christmas is all about. I just want to give you an opportunity to do that today. Can we do that this morning? Just bow your heads for a moment. Father, we just ask today that once again you would come and knock on the door of our hearts. And Lord, we just want to open our hearts now and allow you in today because you keep your promises. Let's just pray this prayer together. Say, Dear Jesus, I open the door of my heart and I say, Come in, Jesus. Forgive my sins. Live with me. Be in me. Help me to live for you. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We have one final song for you, and then we'll be done. We want to encourage you to stick around afterwards. There's coffee and cookies up there. And also, we're going to have a couple people up here. If you would like prayer for anything when we're done this morning, there'll be a couple people standing up there, and you can just come up and receive prayer. Thank you for being here. ahead and stand, and you can be dismissed.